gracious to Narendra. Master said with a smile, "But when? It is true that no one starves at the temple of Annapurna in Benares, but some must wait for food till evening." Once Hriday said, asked, "Sambhu Malik,
Om Danya Grihitva Upanishadam Mahastram Sharam Hupasanashita Sandhyayita Ayamya Tad Bhavakatena Chetasa Laksham Tadevaksharam Somya Vidhi Om Shantihi Shantihi Shantihi. Taking as weapon that mighty bow furnished by the Upanishads and other non-dual scriptures, fasten to it the arrow of mind, made sharpened by thoughts on reality alone. Then drawing full strength, O student, release and penetrate the mark, that imperishable Brahman. Om, peace, peace, peace. Om adihi sa samyoga namitahe tu kalas trikala dukalopi dristaha tam visvarupam bhavabhutam idyam devam satyatastam upasya purvam om shantihi shantihi shantihi. Meditate upon the Lord as thine own self, seated in your heart, who appears to you as the universe, and who is the ultimate source of all living beings. Perceive that one as the primal cause of the relationship between spirit and matter, and as the partless divine entity transcending the three phases of time. Om, peace, peace. Om Satyena, Om Satyena, Labhyastapasa He Satma, Samyagyanena, Brahmacharyena Nicham, Antaha Sharirehi, Jyotirmayo Hi Shubraha, Yam Pashanti, Atayaha Kshina Doshaha, Om Shanti, Shanti, Shanti. The Atman, the indivisible self, in all beings and all things, is realized by knowledge, by moderation, by austerity, and by veracity. All of these constantly cultivated. When mental impurities dissolve, due to this practice, then the seer beholds it everywhere, existing in everything, even here in this very body. Om, peace, peace, peace. May peace be unto us, and may peace be unto all. Om Hari Om. So with those three very profound slokas from Upanishads and other non-dual scriptures, we take a deeper look still into the Adhyatma Ramayana, Adhyatma Upanishad. Adhyatma Ramayana is also another beautiful non-dual scripture that you can take up and study. We've done that before here in SRV several times. But the Adhyatma Upanishad is one of those quote-unquote minor Upanishads, which Shankar didn't get around to commenting on in his short 32-year-old life. He did so much else, but he did take 10 or 11 of those Upanishads and comment on them, and we know those to be very authoritative. And so the ones that he didn't comment on, I think he left those for us to follow up. He blazed a trail. Now we have to look into these non-dual scriptures. And that's what we've been doing in SRV for the past several years, particularly since Swami Vivekananda's 150th sesquicentennial, which happened just recently. Now we're taking up some of these Upanishads, which they're not even books for yet, in English and some other language, so we have to print them out from certain sources. I hope you all have your copies with you. So from last time, over the last 2 weekends, including this weekend, we've had 3 classes, and this is the 4th class, and we've wended our way through some 29 slokas. Yesterday we took up 27, 28, and 29, and we looked at stages of progress according to the gunas. Remember that chart. And we also looked at the various types of quiescence of mind, that is some 6, 7, or 8 pathways that you can take to get to peace of mind, because as Holy Mother says, you need peace of mind first and foremost. So that means you will not probably make any appreciable progress spiritually unless you can quell that restless mind. Or as Patanjali says in one of his Yoga Sutras, citta vritti nirodha. Yogash citta vritti nirodha. In yoga, you must quell those mind waves and send them back to their source. And so getting control of the mind and its thoughts, and thereby what makes the thoughts rise and fall, like the gunas and so forth, and the desire of the ego, is really the main directive of the spiritual aspirant, till they can arrive at such a time, as Lord Vishishta says, when their mind just rests in the Atman, naturally so, and all the things that arise and fall all around it, like waves on an ocean, simply cease. That's why we had this beautiful sloka on cessation yesterday. And the soul can then ponder deeper things. Might be say that the lake is then clear of ripples, and that mind lake. And then one can see one's reflection in it, and also, as Vivekananda said, see the collection of treasures that lie at the bottom of the ocean, like beds of pearls and coral and so forth. So he also said that people only get a glimpse of that sometimes. So he was talking about the rising and falling of a great ocean and its waves, which is not at rest. So when the wave rises, that's joy, you see, and oh, I've got riches, I've got power, I've got enjoyment, and objects are mine, and so forth. And then when the ocean goes really deep, I'm depressed, I'm unhappy, everything is meaningless. So, see, back and forth it goes. But he said on that deep plunge, then you can see the bed of coral and gems below. So it's when in the midst of this deep down depression, if it's a worldly person, that they might get a glimpse of it. But if those hard times come to a spiritual aspirant, then they have more wherewithal. They have their faculties about them, and they know somewhere inside of them that these things pass, and they just wait them out. These things are basically three in number. They're called gunas. So we looked at that yesterday, the modes of nature, that is basically inertia and frenetic activity or restlessness, and then balance, sattva. And it's a great teaching in Vedanta, but really the deeper part of the teaching is that you must get beyond balance too. Most people reach a kind of balance, and that would be a sort of subtle bliss that attends upon them all the time. So they're going to need to get beyond this personal store of bliss, which is why we ended with this teaching on bliss yesterday. Remember how we ended too. It might be nice to begin that way, just take it right up. Vijita sahasra kairaika sahasra karaika sahasra karaika nute Kritu surata raka sangarata raka sangarata raka sumunute Suratha sumadi samana samadi samadi samani sajararate Jaya jaya he mahishasura mardini ramyaka pardini shailasute Jaya jaya he mahishasura mardini ramyaka pardini shailasute. One of the verses out of the Durga Stotram, Sri Durga Mahishasura Stotram, that is the slayer of Mahisha, the great evil, the great demon. And this one of these lines says Surata Samadhi Samana Samadhi 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 Samadhi. You could go on saying that word over and over again, and probably would come to a sort of conclusion that that's the way a great soul looks at life, as Samadhi, people are looking at life in different ways, to get things, to enjoy things, to become attached, to desire things. They hate life. They want out of life. A couple of people in the last 3 weeks telling me about how they want to commit suicide. Then some want to transcend it because it's limited and so forth. But the seers really are fine with it. It sounds like when you hear Buddhism and Vedanta that they're not fine with it. They want you out of it. But they want you out of life in ignorance. If you can enter life with your faculties intact, with all your wherewithal, you see, then you can do anything. Even the great non-dual stotrams say so. Like we sang one last night when we sang Hastamalaka Stotram. See, I'm not a merchant or a householder or a monk or a wonder or any of this. I'm just a non-dual self. I exist at all times. And verses like that roll on and on as if to say, whether I'm in the body or whether I'm outside the body makes no never mind to me. I'm fine with it all because I am the eternal self. Maybe essentially nameless and formless and timeless and deathless, but I can venture into time if I have all my faculties and all my powers, all my yogic powers collected, and I'm ready for this battle, you see, for this challenge. Like a warrior or like a seer, a sage. So it seems to me if you look at the samadhis of Patanjali, you'll see that this is true. So let's start out that way on the note of samadhi, and it's in accord with these three slokas, 27, 28, 29, which say, upon realizing the self that is the uninterrupted bliss of one's own essence, the timeless bliss that is the self gets savored, both externally and internally. Does it sound like that summates what I just said? See? And once you find the self, you rest in it, then that bliss that is the self gets savored, and it's internal or external, bahir antaram va, whichever way you find yourself, in whatever condition you find yourself, you'll find that's the truth, that it's one indivisible and infinite ocean of pure conscious awareness, and it's unaffected by anything that comes from its own maya, and anything that comes from the collective cosmic and individual mind that projects forms and names in time and space. So that's what they have found, and that's why they are the way they are, and that's why they proclaim it all to be samadhi. First of all, there's knowledge samadhi. See, we looked at it. Savitarka, with its nirvitarka complement. The condition is accompanied by gross thought, focused on names and form, mixed with the gunas, and shadowed by doubt. That's a kind of lower samadhi. Samadhi with objects, they call it, but you're working it out. You're working out seeing through the objects, not getting attached to the objects, not having desire for objects, not coveting objects, or if you want to put it in a more positive vein, seeing that objects are empty of, one, any substance, because they're just vibrating particles that have come out of your mind. You see, the mind's particles, mind's thoughts have projected the articles, and the articles are actually manifestations of your mind. The power of solidity was in your head. And number two, that they're empty of any ability to fulfill you. Yeah. That should be clear to most people by now. When you see all the suffering in the world, that should be what you shouldn't have compassion for suffering. Well, how can you do anything against this ocean of universal suffering? When you see the suffering, you should say, oh, I see what the reason is. I'm out of it. I'm out of here, you see. And any sensible person would do that. But this inordinate attachment, this selfish clinging, this grasping to the atomic particle, for instance, by an opulent civilization, you see, is this unreasoned. And the seers are having none of it and never have had any of it. They would like their samadhi unattended, without limited adjuncts, and without false superimpositions. Someone's listening in my class. So these two things are the main points of this Upanishad in its first 27 slokas. False superimposition is the main thing you hear about Vivarta or Adhyasa when you hear Vedanta. And if you have innate intelligence, you'll snap to right away. Right away means a year, 10 years, or a lifetime, depending on people with this innate intelligence. But if you haven't developed the samskara and the qualification for this great eternal dharma, which transcends countries and transcends religions, then it will take you longer. You'll have to plant some seeds. Well, these are called seeded samadhis. See, sampragyata means seeded. So they're seeded by something. They're seeded by your experiences in name and form, in time and space. That's why he's saying here that they're accompanied by gross thought. You've got sort of a habit of that. And you're not thinking of it as habit, you're thinking of it as life. Your parents never said, oh, you've got a habit of objects, you see. They have a habit of objects. It's a part of the ordinary mind to have that samskara around objects and the desires for them. And did anyone ever tell you it was bad to covet objects? Isn't the government and the politicians and the businessmen, everyone running after objects? And they're not calling it bad or negative. It's only the seers are coming forth and said, you've got a habit of thinking of objects. Why don't you turn that habit into the samadhi of objects? Why don't you look at an object and see that it's pointing you straight to reality? We had just had a retreat on the river, the American River. It was all about, pretty much about Tantra, see, about Shiva and Shakti, and that relationship between the static and the dynamic that's everywhere and in everything. You see a cup with water in it, you know, that's Shiva and Shakti. One's moving, one's stationary, one's containing the other. Now, anywhere you look is this. And the point is to deify all objects, not to covet them, not to own them, not to enjoy them, maybe not even just to custodian them, although that's probably a higher look at it. But you really have to get to the point of what all of this means. Archa is the word in Sanskrit. It means a symbol. That everything is a symbol for divine reality. And the seers are just walking around in archa samadhi. See? As long as they have to have five senses and a mind, and a mind that projects, then whatever rises, they dissolve it back in like bubbles into water every night. Buddhischa yata jale. We dissolve everything that we experienced back into the water of consciousness out of which it came. And we never covet a thing, you see, for ourselves. We're free. So go thou, the free, from place to place, and help them out of darkness, Maya's veils. Without the search for pleasure or fear of pain, go beyond them both, as Swamiji said in his beautiful poem. So they're declaring to you they're free. Everyone from Buddha to Jesus to Shankara to Chaitanya, right on up to the present time with Ramakrishna and Vivekananda and Sharda, the Divine Mother, Holy Mother, peace be upon all of them, are declaring we are the free. We are ever free, never bound. And so if you want to take a tantric look at it, you look at the deification of all objects to see that they're pointers towards your true nature. They all came out of you for one, so you can never be devoid of them. So quit grasping after them. In fact, the fact that you do grasp after them makes them run away further from you. See, that meaning. So you're always pursuing them. Can't you just let that go and let them then move amongst them? If you let it go, they'll come back close to you. You don't have to covet them and own them. They're yours already because they came out of your own mental process. We have not been taught this. The mind only schools. See, we've only been taught to seek the physical, and it's become everything from gaining success to inordinate attachment to things that aren't real. So if you have a Savitarka Samadhi, what's its aim? To refine concentration by focusing on objects, names, and meanings so as to lead to fuller comprehension. I might as well just read this and quit talking, because I give these 5-minute explications on it, and then Pataji comes along and knocks them down with a sentence, you see. Just read my charts. Hear my lips, but read my charts. And what is the method? Striving via basic knowledge to comprehend the world, manifest deities, and the 16 visheshas. That's the evolutes of the mind. See, all the way down to the 5 elements and the 5 senses. All of these you have to take and deify them. So yoga and tantra, that's why they made such a beautiful hybrid, like in Tibetan Buddhism and so forth, is because they encountered each other and they informed each other of each other's perspective. And they found that they were in concurrence for the most part. The names may be a little different in the language and this and that, you see. Maybe one was more monastic and one less so. It didn't matter. It was the truth was the truth. And the truth are us, you see, they said. Now look at the difference between Savitarka Nirvitarka and Savichara Nirvichara. In Savichara, it's pretty much Tarka is reasoning, like Tarkika. It's a word that means kind of reasoning about things. So that's what I'm talking about, this innate intelligence. If you have people that have the power of reasoning, then you know that they're probably okay. You can just say a few things to them and they'll move along, see. But if they don't have this power of reasoning in them, then it's a worse situation. And this gets back to the ocean of suffering and endless rounds of reincarnation and the wheel of time, the Kala Chakra from Buddha, and all these systems that the seers are carefully compassionate about, you see. That is, I call him, Mother said, you could never convince a Hindu man who's got attachment to betel nut to give up chewing it, you see. So, sir, your teeth are going to fall out. See, they're going to turn red and stain, and they're going to fall out. But you tell him that, but he'll go on chewing betel nut anyway until they do fall out, and then he's gumming it, you see. Then he gets cancer of the gums. And it's just this inordinate attachment to this little taste and a slight intoxication that's at the root of it. And so she's saying that as a specific example of this inordinate attachment everyone has to these meaningless things in their life that are driving them crazy. And you see it more and more in the world today. And the little things are becoming a little bigger. Like, it's not a beetle nut anymore. It's a Volkswagen Beetle, you see, or something. It's some bigger thing that you're attached to, you see. And then they're filling the freeways and you can't get anywhere, you see. It's just not only a clog in the mind, it's a clog on the street. The avenues are all clogged, you see, whether they're internal or external. But the seers have freed themselves of that, and the internal and the external are open nadis that are streaming with prana, that are streaming with psychic energy, that are streaming with mentation and reasoning, tarka. So if they reason savi, or they reason chara, if they savi chara would be accompanied by subtle thought, and then instead of gross thought, now you've moved to a subtle thought, and you're having a kind of samadhi around that. Basically what Patanjali's saying here, as far as the philosophical dynamics are concerned, is that as soon as you can concentrate, you're having samadhi. If you can't concentrate, you'll never have it, which is back to our chart yesterday about the gunas. See, if the gunas are rising and falling and you have no control of them, restlessness, slothfulness, a little balance, and back and forth, like a ping pong ball game or a tennis match, you see, you look up in the audience, people are going like this, you know, for like 3 or 4 hours. They take a little break, have some coffee, go to the next match. It's sort of like that's the way this is, you see, the mind. It's this dual by nature, and it bounces from one side to the other, and you know, later complains about a sore neck. So gross thought to subtle thought, but when you were able to get rid of those gross thoughts, then you have this ability to reason about, you know, you might say, well, maybe these things aren't so precious, you see. And maybe these things are passing and ephemeral even. And maybe I should look for their source. And then all of a sudden you find out that all the beautiful things out here you thought had their origin inside of you. First you might be thinking it's inside my thought process, but you're not putting it together that the thought actually produced the object yet. But nobody thinks that way. Nature produced the object, and you're a part of nature. But they're not seeing that you're actually the witness of nature before you came into it. And then when you came into it, you used it. You put it together into worlds and trees and forests and countries and mountains and streams and billion suns in the sky were your thoughts. And that was all the source of all of this was inside of you. At the retreat two weekends ago in the American River, I just looked at everyone and said, tell me, will you, where are the kingdoms of heaven? And Jesus said they were within you. Or within, and so they're not out there, and they're not in your body, see. That's the only within they know about is, you know, let's look within everything. Let's look inside the object called the body, and then they find out nerves and blood vessels and flows of blood, but they're missing what causes the blood to flow, prana. They're missing what causes the lungs to breathe, prana. They're missing what causes the eyes to see, prana. It's missing. The life force by which everything outside is upheld. Who said that? Sri Krishna in the Gita. You heard it 2 weeks ago on retreat. That's my subtle body. That's the life force out of which, by which everything is upheld. That's my prana. That's my unmanifested form. And that's missing. The second world is missing to contemporary civilizations. Even in India now. Forgetting it. So the first world is a gross world of gross thought. You see, the second world is a subtle world of subtle thought. And you have you now have an ability to reason about it because you can concentrate. And that concentration is giving you samadhi and you don't know it yet. That's how I would summate it over the last 20 or 30 years of presenting yoga to people. I present Vedanta, I present Tantra, I present Buddhism, I present Zen Buddhism, I present yoga, and I present Samkhya, and Krishna's Gita and Yoga Vishishta's scripture, that is Vishishta's yoga. So all of those things, if you look at them for as long as I've looked at them, which is probably more than this lifetime, then you'll find that this is what's beginning to occur to you, and you can summate it in a certain way quick, while we have a chance. You see why this bubble called America is still, you know, there. It hasn't popped yet, you see. Throwing everything into chaos and disarray. That's how Maya works for the illumined souls. Oh, good, Maya's working, so now we can go over here and do something secret, you see. While they get all attached to Maya, gives us a chance to go over here and meditate on ourselves and extract a few people from it and teach them, you see. So they can get free and not have to come back into it again. Or watch it from a distance and utilize it. What is the aim of Savichara? To transcend the imperfections in nature and perceive the subtle essence of things. Well, there it is, you see. They're giving you the directive to transcend nature, gross nature. Why would they want you to do that? Is it just objects and attachment to them, or is there a secret, a deeper secret, like, say, called prana, psychic prana? Or maybe the secret that this is all connected inside to you. That the world has come out of you. In the Mahamudra of Tibetan Buddhism, there are three things you need. First is called the view, and the view is all manifest things have come out of the mind. It's like, you know, key Mahamudra Tibetan Buddhist teaching. The great seal, they call it. If you have this great seal, you can stamp it on everything, or see that everything is stamped with it. And then you have something solid, you know, to build your house on. Instead of shifting sands, you can build it on the bedrock of this view. And that view will take you towards a transcendent view, if it's not already transcendent. The aim is to transcend imperfections in nature, then. So you love nature, but there are imperfections in it, like birth, growth, disease, old age, decay, death, and so forth. You're going to just take those along with the package? Well, if you do and you suffer them, then you have what's called a mixed samskara for life. An inordinate attachment to time and space and a desire to be reborn. Whether you believe in rebirth or not, you still are creating a desire to be reborn. It's according to both Patanjali and Vedavyas, the father of yoga and the father of Vedanta. This is called samskara, or deep impression in your mind, to be reborn again. And there's one word I'm thinking of right now. Ancestors. You'll get into a religion that worships its ancestors only. And they're in some heaven somewhere. That is some heaven that's somewhere out there, maybe. Have to look up in the stars for it. But science doesn't want to do that, because they don't believe in anything like that. See, but they won't look inside past the atom either. So heaven just doesn't exist, or it's some place outside of you. But if you encountered it as some place inside of you, and then you took the place away, see, then you'd get more of the idea that the seers are realizing. It's not a place. It's a chamber in your mind. Everything is a chamber in your mind. You're sitting in a chamber of your mind right now. This room inside a house, inside a city, inside a world, inside of infinite space is all inside of the mind. Time is inside of the mind. Space is inside of the mind. As Vivekananda said, where's the time when the soul will come and go? When all of time is in the soul. And where's the space it will come to and go to or leave and part from when all of time is in the soul and all of space is in the soul? So they're trying to get you to see this. And this is how they've become free, or how they remain free. In the case of Vivekananda, how he was ever free, never bound. Vivekananda called him Nityasiddha, eternally perfect, free soul. That such a soul would take it upon himself to come into the Kali Yuga in the year 1893 and come to America and dawn upon us this teaching and have that much faith in us means you have a responsibility to realize it, and your responsibility is to you first and then to your ancestors. And that's the only reason that the ancestors are valid to you. Otherwise, the world is a deep pit and your ancestors are vipers inside of it. Whether it's their fault or yours, it's the case, you see. Birds have nests, foxes have holes. Son of man has no place to lay his head here. Grant unto Caesar what is Caesar's. I've not come to bring a sword, a peace. I've come to bring a sword, and I'll separate father and son with it. Because father believes in Brahman and son doesn't, or vice versa. See. One has some tarka and the other is absent of tarka. See. Doesn't have any reasoning power in them. They're just weak. Puerile and attached to anything they see, taste, touch, hear, or smell. They don't have the wherewithal to lift themselves out of even attachment to a dented tin pot holding another set. I can't give this up, see. Or, you know, smoke a cigarette if you want. How about one a week? Or one a day if you must. What's this packs after packs? Some young man wrote me last week and said, this woman was talking to me and she was complaining about her great-grandmother died of cancer and her grandmother died of cancer and her daughter's contracting cancer, and she didn't know why this was happening, and all the time she's smoking a cigarette while she's telling him this. You see, people don't connect the effect to the cause. They can just live in Maya and just be completely clueless about the ramifications themselves and the fact that those ramifications are their own doing, and they're busy dealing out the fault to the devil or praising the Lord. Neither of those exist. Only the great self inside of you exists. And you can't free yourself. Even when you hear the truth about karma, you're still clinging to grace, or you're still clinging to Maya. That's why Sheshananda here in this city spoke in 1980 and said, Christianity is a thoroughly dualistic religion. Why dualistic? Because they believe in a soul. But that's not the soul they're worshiping, it's the ego. They think it's the soul. So, words again, please. False superimposition, right. False superimposition of the non-self over the self. See, the ego over the soul in this case. Now, the ego samadhi is much different, you see. It's very, very beautiful kind of thing. It's ripened. It's sweet. It's the fount of individual bliss. That's a quote from Patanjali. The fount of individual bliss. Now, before we take it up, just this method, you see, in Savichara Samadhi, you're striving via subtle knowledge to try and comprehend the six avisheshas. So you've left behind air, earth, fire, water, and ether, seeing, tasting, touching, hearing, and smelling. That's pretty much the Savitarka level, right? Gross things. And you've connected them all, like water to taste and fire to sight and so forth. So you know that they're not just five separate quintuplications, but they're actually connected to one another. This is how you're finding your way in to the connection. You see, you can't find the self without making the connections of the non-self back to the origin. It's called utpati in Sanskrit. You look for the origins of things, and that's not just seeing the origins and saying, oh, that's the effect of that cause, but it's actually connecting one to the other. In this case, fives to fives to fives. And notice that one five comes out of the other five. Now, they do so because they're connected. It's not just random. All this give you 5 feet and five toes and five fingers and five senses and five elements. But let's just, call it a coincidence. You see? And then let's forget all about it. It doesn't have any connection whatsoever to anything inside of you. Let's erase that. Erase, erase. So you get to the subtle body, and the ego is one of the things you're going to be meditating on. You're going to be taking it up now. See? So it's accompanied by higher intelligence, focused on the subtlemost causes, and enraptured by sattvic bliss. Sound better? Sananda. Sa means with. Near means without, or devoid of. So sananda, it's with bliss, samadhi. You're having it now. You're beginning to have the samadhi. Don't get stuck in it like you got stuck in the happiness of a dented tin pot, but move on, you see. It's a seated samadhi, and you're looking for the unseated state. To concentrate on refined ego and enjoy the fount of bliss contained in the personal sense of I-ness is the aim of this samadhi. Perhaps it's what the New Agers mean when they say follow your bliss, but I don't know if they've made a very deep study of yoga yet. They're still probably just doing asanas and breathing some. But if you go into this level of concentration, which is the fifth limb, dharana, by the way, you would have had to have accomplished pratyahara, removal of the mind from objects, and this is why these are valuable, these first two samadhis. And then you're going to be more likely to gain concentration. It's very unlikely you will, except in forced moves of maya, and maybe a little grace will attend upon you, or a profound dream might come when you're in a more sattvic state. These are glimpses. We looked at them yesterday. You see in one of the charts. They're glimpses. And they don't change you. They don't transform you. In fact, you tend to forget them when parents or your doctor tells you they're figments of your imagination. And you must be regular. You must be ordinary. So you must just be like everyone else. Follow the conventions, not the tradition. My teacher didn't yell at us every day in my ashram here in Portland, you see. Follow the convention! He yelled at us, follow the tradition. He meant Vedanta and its concomitants, yoga, Buddhism, Tantra, Zen. These are all India. And they're smack of India, even if you put 52 generations between them, like in the case of Zen and India. When Buddhism came to China. So you can't take India out of India. And thank God for that too. It's named Bharat before the Hindus, before the English named it Hinduism after India. Bharat was the eternal land. There was no beginning, middle, and end to it, nor to the wisdom that they were graced with when they first set foot on the Indus River Valley, worshipping Shiva and Shakti as the divine feminine and the divine masculine, and their union and what that all meant, as if to prepare this ground for the Vedic incursion to bring this higher knowledge, because they had qualified themselves already through ritual, through authentic worship. They saw the world as it really was. Number one, unreal, and number two, a sign to move inside. So thousands of years later, Patanjali probably had many births, and so did Vedavyas. Some, I think, like some 20-some every Mahayuga, he's born to keep the Vedanta alive. In fact, Krishna says that I've been born as Vedavyas many times. So you see the connection between Vedanta and the Vaishnavism should never have been sundered in the first place. It's one. And so when, by the time Patanjali's born, maybe 600, 700 years after Lord Buddha, he's taking it, he's paying it forward, he's making it current, and he's showing you that you can take all this wisdom that's been repeated over and over again and is echoing out there in the ethers and bouncing back at you every lifetime, and you can truncate it and concentrate it and bring it right here into the moment, into some six forms of samadhi. You see, five of them will be seeded, and they're avenues by which you can get back to your true nature, back to your true self. Very clearly expounded upon by Patanjali, and 40 other very famous commentators came along after him. These are Indian commentators. The ones in the West are not really getting much of the true gist of the matter. But the Indian commentators are coming along and giving you the real meaning of this, the real connections, the real quintessential wisdom of India is there. And it's based on a samskara that you have for it. See, you have samskaras that are negative and mixed, but you have these samskaras that are very positive too, that you can pull yourself up by your bootstraps every life that you live and stay on vigil, as we said yesterday, right? Stay on vigil. So what about the method of Sananda? Transcending the gross and subtle objects to attain the enjoy and enjoy the bliss of refined ahamkara. Refined ahamkara. We were singing about that refined ego and its various import. In fact, some of you might remember even, because it's only a couple weeks old. Vardhanateshvara Purna Maheshvara Shanti Sudara Kasharva Shiva Arda Maheshvara Purna Maheshvara Shanti Sudarnava Shanti Shiva Samsararnava Taraka Shankara Sahajananda Mahesh Shiva Samsararnava Taraka Shankara Sahajananda Mahesh Shiva Hara Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Samba Shiva Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Samba Shiva Hara Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Sambasada Shiva Samba Shiva.
So it's this Shiva Stotram that we all learned some 15 verses of at the retreat 2 weeks ago, and that we've been singing in SRV for some 20 years. The Sri Shivanam Samkirtanam. Ardhan Teshwara Purna Maheshwara Shanti Sudaraka. But the point that connects here is Samsararnava Taraka Shankara Sahajananda. You see, the natural bliss of realization is there. So that means the consummate one who is ever full, who balances male and female energies within him. You know, Shiva looks so beautiful. Sometimes it's like a foxy lady, you see. Sometimes like a big hunk, you see. you want to try and describe it to the world. But just balance these male and female energies. We had even a young man with us 2 weeks ago that looked like Shiva, this young 22-year-old man. We were saying we were going to put him on the altar and like dress him up like Shiva. Maybe he'd go into samadhi like Sri Ramakrishna. So, who dances masterfully yet remains peaceful and content, who appeared as the magical Sarabha. This is like a kind of a magical deer that's stronger than a lion. It's a deer that's stronger than a lion. It's in the Itihasa of India. He dances like that, and who bestows peace and saves all beings from delusion, whose bliss is natural and spontaneous, Sahajananda. That's why singing this, because it reminded me of this Sananda Samadhi. See, it's by that time the ego is ripened. Its method is transcending the gross and subtle objects to attain the and enjoy the bliss of refined ahamkara, self. They say, you know, self is the first ego self, ahamkara is the first lost soul. First lost soul in the forest of the world. It decided it would separate itself from Brahman. Big mistake. So it needs to find itself. But in its original condition, it was so close to Brahman when it separated itself from that, just like a baby is still close to God when it's born to the mother's womb. It still has that bliss and light in it, you see. And in that way, when the soul separates itself from Brahman, it still has the awareness of this bliss, and it loses that through this trickle-out process, you see, of consciousness down through the subtle objects, to the gross objects, and then plants itself there in the body and forgets. So its fate is to be a lost soul among lost souls, see. It needs to find itself. That's why all the illumined souls, they have two objectives when they get here. Find a teacher and get initiated. Right away, young as they can. Shankara, 6. Vivekananda in his teens. So sooner the better to get that done and out of the way, so you have an anchor back to yourself, your true nature. If this is planted in your mind early on, this seed, seeded samadhis, then you will find the unseeded state by the end of your life. After living a whole life in the world, Vachisha said yesterday, if contentment does not come to you, then something is wrong. That is, this life you're living in the world, if you don't end up with peace and contentment, something went wrong. You should be sporting here, never forgetting. And if you have to be on vigil, like I was saying yesterday in class, then, you know, that's the second best. Why should you have to be on vigil? Why shouldn't you just be enjoying the bliss of the self, even if it is the smaller self? Because, let me tell you, the people that are enjoying the self out there, the ego, that's a mixed bag. They're not having any real bliss, even of individual kind. They're having a rebellious ego fit, you see. That's a real mixed bag, and sometimes it turns worse, like into a can of worms. So that ego, ahamkara ego, that's get thee behind me ego, you see. Erase, erase. So you want this ego samadhi, that vindicates ego, makes it okay to be an individual self. You'll find your Purusha is separate from Prakriti at that point, see, like oil and water. Won't mix. The Lord said, Divine Mother said, oh, they're going down into all the worlds. What do I do? It's just so Maya, so thick down there. Let's see, I think I'll invent oil and water. See, put them together. Maybe someone will come along sometime and try and mix them. Give them a broad hint, you know, that soul and matter never mix. I just chanted this morning, see, basically when we started the class about that. Yeah. And meditate upon your own self as the Lord seated in your heart. who is the primal cause of the relationship between spirit and matter. See, so there is a two separate things there, and there's a relationship, but it's never going to be one and the same. See, one's insentient, the other's sentient, so they can't really mix. The only way in which they can be one is that one came out of the other. See, so that's the death of duality right there. You're not thinking in dual terms anymore. Neither are you thinking like a green coconut. See, your head's a green coconut. See, it hasn't split into layers yet. It's still unripe. That's how Sri Ramakrishna had explained it. People don't have the discrimination yet to separate things into compartments and look at them. One's real, one's unreal. So they're just saying, it's all one, it's all one. Big philosophical mistake. Oneness only exists in the sense that nature came out of the soul, but that's a projection, and the projection is not real, ultimately. The only reality is you. And they have sayings for that. Sayings after sayings after sayings after sayings. Some of them very profound. We'll look at them soon. But finish up this final samadhi, sasmita. It's the bliss of the self, and then there's the actual self itself. Let's see. Lord Buddha, the Buddhists, I think, is kind of funny because they really take exception to the word self, but Lord Buddha himself said, who is the master of the self? The self is master of the self. Who else would be the master? So in the English transliteration, you find the first self capitalized and the second self lowercase, you see. So the self, uppercase, is master of the lower self. So there is this need to discriminate between the real and the unreal, for as long as you see the real and the unreal as two things. You begin to lose that sense here in the bliss of the ego. And there's a very key and very subtle thing that happens here. The subtleties of Brahman, which we'll get to next, is extreme subtleties, levels of Brahman subtlety, is that the ego will turn away from its own individual bliss eventually. Even though it's a fount, it's still a fount of individual bliss only, and it makes it, it's like a firefly seeing a sun. All of a sudden, it has light, the sun has light, but then it compares its light to that and says, I think I'll go there. See, I think I'll give up this individual light. How long can I enjoy it? For about as long as I could enjoy the objects of the world. See, then I must give them up. So in sasmita, that means with sense of asmita, as with that sense of self. So it's accompanied by self-convergence, focused on I-ness, and transcendent of the sattva guna. It's one way in which Patanjali lets you know about the time the gunas should start going away, especially sattva guna. There is a time when that happens, and that's what this little here is about. I'll read it to you in a second. The aim, to meditate on the unified self as I am, in accord with the highest cosmic principles. Because you've transcended the lower cosmic principles and the middling cosmic principles there, the visheshas and the avisheshas, you've transcended them. So now you can actually get to the source of all this, the mind, ego, intellect complex. See, the antakarana. So now you can meditate because you've seen all of those and you've put all of those behind you as being insentient and as being changing. Then you want to get to the source of all this change, and that's you. So you are the source of bliss, and you are the source of change, both. And you're going to have to pick one. See? And seer ends up picking the source of consciousness, not the source of bliss. That is limited bliss, see. There is a word called ananda, but that's a part of sat-chit-ananda, the three great modes to describe Brahman through: pure existence, pure knowledge, and pure bliss. So the ananda you know, has given rise to all the bhakti schools, pretty much, see. And the chit has given rise to all the wisdom schools, and the sat has given rise to all the I am schools, you see, pure existence. So it's a way you can think of Satchitananda, which is one of the prime words for divine reality. Very explanatory. You looked into the word Brahman, you see. Brih means to expand. Well, Brahman doesn't expand, so you're already kind of having to put your mind on these things. But you look into the word Satchitananda and you see these three complements of Brahman, which are its essence, and the schools that come off of it of thinking. See, it's sort of like the original cause of truth and philosophy, as far as anything else inside the realm of form goes, anyway. Be the first thing you consider. And the first thing you snap to and run back to when you find yourself in the body. Guru and initiation, I said. If you get that, you're an open candidate for these schools. Otherwise, they're just, you don't even know they exist. You forget about the existence of Brahman, or you don't believe anymore in God. There are two great doctrines. The existence of God and the non-existence of God. Where did you hear that? About 20 or 30 minutes ago from him. He was reading before the live streaming audience joined us. He read it. It was Sri Ramakrishna's words. There are two great doctrines, the existence of God and non-existence of God. And the master told the man, why don't you just accept the first? About this time, Lex Hickson, my dear friend and founder of SRV, and I would look at each other and go, why not? Yeah, let's just accept the first. The non-existence of God is a very profound doctrine in its truth, you see, because it's true, there is no God. It's a perplexing thing. Vivekananda came here and said, there is no God, there is no devil, there's just the great self. You can call that God if you want, but that's why most religions don't want to assign a word for it. But a word like Satchitananda, of course, is a very deep designation. India's never been afraid of anything. It's fearless. So philosophically, it must be the same. Anything we can use, any method, every rock and to turn over and every dark corner to look into, we'll throw the light in it so that all beings can come to this realization of I am the self in all. All worlds both here and there, all life both here and there, will I renounce, heavens, earths, and hells, hopes, and fears. Thus cut thy bonds. I will know the great self, and that self is I. So saying here, basically, the sense of I-ness, the I am. It was the sense of I-ness in the samadhi here, but in this samadhi it begins to become the I am. So there's this inexplicable tendency of this great being to turn back to its source and away from its own individual bliss. There are beings in higher worlds who live in their own individual bliss. They're called Prakriti Layas, and they can't realize Brahman. There's a subtle veil between them and Brahman. They can see the light, they can't go to it. It's sort of like a soul at death. You can see the light, Buddha nature, and the Tibetan Rinpoche says, see that? Go to it. Merge in it. They try, so you can't do it. Have to assign themselves somewhere in the Shambhala worlds, you see. Or go back to Earth later, you see. But to merge into Brahman is a very, very, it's the ultimate goal. It's the paragatam that Buddha talked about. Merge completely into Buddha nature. But you won't be able to do it until you get by this sense of personal bliss and get to the real examination of what the self is. It's a samadhi of who am I, kind of, if you want to take this and put it next to Atmavichara and Vedanta. The method, transcending the ego to unify meditator, act of meditation, and object of meditation. There's really no words that are going to describe this very well, this subtle move, but this is how the seers would put it. The Triputi of, we studied Triputis yesterday, right? Had a whole chart of Triputis before you. Well, here's a very good Triputi that Patanjali uses in order to get rid of that sense of individual I-ness and just include everything. The all-inclusive realization of Nirvikalpa Samadhi, or Asamprajnata. It's the transcendent awareness, formless, acognitive, or Nirvikalpa and Vedanta, as compared to the cognitive state of awareness in four levels here. Now, if you want a quick summation, which although is very powerful, mind with gunas and nature present expands towards freedom. You see, with rajas eliminated, that's restlessness, intellect discriminates between matter and self. The early stages of seated samadhi are encountered and attained. That is, you master them. The final level of sampragata brings about dharma mega samadhi. So all the rain cloud of virtues come to you unasked. There were nothing that you could really attain anyway. They were in you already, and you just had to remove certain things. Sri Ramakrishna said, if there's a stack of books and there's a book on the bottom that you want, you're going to have to remove all the ones on top. It's a real drag. Life in the worlds of gross objects, you see. But you're going to have to do that to get this book on the bottom. So similarly, mentally, philosophically, intellectually, you're going to have to do that in this Sampragata case to get to these Dharma Mega Samadhi. Then Chit-Shakti illumines the Buddhi and becomes stable and desireless. So Chit-Shakti, Divine Mother in Yoga, there she is there. You find her in all the religions, Shakina in Judaism and Fatima in Muslim, and Saraswati in Vedic religion and so forth. Mother is there and everywhere. So even a sort of non-denominational and system of psychological purification like yoga has her there, you know, Chit-Shakti. She comes forward and illumines your intellect. Before that it was dim, you see. It was looking through a glass darkly. And all of a sudden she comes forth and illumines. The triple gunas of prakriti get duly dissolved back into their origins then. The death, the destruction of all things is the return to their source. Who said that? Yes. Shri Ramachandra Kripalu Bhajamana Arna Bhava Vayadharana. May I concentrate dharana on Sri Ram and remove all of these impediments. See, the gunas, for instance, one of the three of the most subtle of all impediments. I'll even get beyond sattva eventually, you see. That is my attachment to subtle individual bliss that I'm, you know, loving right now, you see. Oh, my life is perfect. Everything is going well. It'll pass. Oh, I'm really suffering. It's so hard. It'll pass. That's the problem with relativity. It's always passing, changing. This is why eventually you want to get out of the bath. See? I'm clean, I want out. I was working with an invalid person once, you know, they were in the bath. I walked in. How are you enjoying your bath? I'm clean, I want to get out. It was nice, but, you know, it's dirty water. Everything becomes dirty water in form, the realm of form, pretty soon to you. You want somebody to lift you out of it. So, Sri Ramchandra, why not? Why not? Then, after Chit-Shakti and the gunas are taken care of, the dissolution of sattva guna brings about a sampragata samadhi. They say you will have to get on top of the gunas to get this seedless samadhi, a sampragata. Purusha now controls the mind's activities and is free from samsara. Samsara arna, but we just sang it. Shiva is free from that. Purusha now controls the mind's activities and is free from samsara. So the real soul, Purusha, has taken back the throne from the ego. Oh, you had your play. Did you like it? Well, I liked some of it, and other parts I didn't like. That's why I'm here. All right, Purusha says, die, ego. And then one just merges into other. The individual apparent self merges into the individual real self, Purusha, and that is looking to merge into Brahman, the great self. So steps of the ego. Sri Ramakrishna called this as unripe ego and ripe ego, ripening ego and ripe ego. It's really very much in accord with how Vivekananda interpreted Patanjali's five states of the mind. First it's scattered, then it's gathering, then it's gathered, then it's concentrated, and then it's one. So ego is part of the mind complex, so you know they'll describe it in different ways to you. So you can sort of be aware of what's happening to you to a certain extent as you make this inner journey. Penultimately, attachment to matter ceases, but the Buddhi still conducts relationships between matter and spirit. See, that is to look upon that as the primordial cause of the relationship between matter and spirit. Purusha and Prakriti. Brahma and its Maya, if you want to say. This will go on, you see. Until the yogi interacts with the world, but the chit-shakti within abides calmly despite all appearances. So you become that witness consciousness we talked about. What's very beautiful is Vedavyasa is only looking at yoga, because we know that he took a look at the eight-limbed yoga, and then he had so many beautiful commentaries on it. When the mind field expands to know the underlying principles which support it, that is called vitarka, up top. When it seeks a more refined expansion in order to comprehend the subtle supports behind appearances, that is known as vichara. When bliss is experienced upon knowing the gross and the subtle, that is termed ananda, sattvic joy. And when evidence of a unified self occurs, which allows the removal of all distinctions, this is known as asmita. Beautiful. See, I mean, how can you summate the eight-limbed yoga in a couple sentences? A great mind can, the father of Vedanta can. So it's not going to dawn on people who aren't qualified to hear it, but it's going to intrigue those who are, and then it's going to cause others who are set and determined to realize their self in this lifetime to take this apart and look at systems like this. The eight-limbed yoga of Patanjali, named after him, Patanjala, or also called Raja Yoga, the kingly, noble way, also called Ashtanga, the eight-limbed yoga. So we look at that in accord with the Adhyatma Upanishad sloka that says, upon realizing the self that is uninterrupted bliss of one's own essence, the timeless bliss that is the self gets savored, both externally and internally. So you have Patanjali's description of the four here, and then you have really a further explanation of the four here by Vedavyasa. You'll find those in the Yoga Sutras and in Vedavyasa's commentary on Yoga Sutras. Besides, we've just taken about a 10-year look at yoga through the email. And that's going to become a book now. But we have maybe a group of 50 to 100 people who've participated over this time, all given their questions and answers. And I'm busy putting that into a book form now. It's going to be a testament of a cross-section of American culture and how they looked at the full eight-limbed yoga and not just hatha and asana, that is pranayama and so forth, that most people are stuck in, but a group of people with tarka, with reasoning power, and with depth and intelligence who wanted to know what yoga really is. It's not just the cessation of the mind's waves, then, is it? It's a good beginning, but it's got much deeper depths to plumb. There, on that chart, is the beautiful Saraswati. Vani Saraswati Vagdevi Bhagavati Parvati Nampari Veena Pani
hamsavahini vedanta rupini purayama ani saraswati vakdevi bhagavati parvati nam.
She is the mother of the word, as we looked at, and that's why where I want to go next, to the word. In the time remaining in the first half, it will be in accord with this sloka 30. We've arrived. The express sense of the word tat has maya for its adjunct. That tat is the causeless cause of all worlds. Don't let words, Sanskrit words, throw you off. Think of the English. It's the cause of all worlds, that. They don't want to give it a name. They're just saying that. Tat is another word for Brahman, for divine reality. Just like Turiya is another word for, it just means the fourth. You know, they don't want to name it. Have you thinking denominationally or philosophically, just say that or the fourth, you see. Gives you this inkling without giving you any kind of conditioning around it yet, philosophically or otherwise. So it gives you a sense and a taste of it. Further, it is characterized by omniscience tinged with transcendence. Very good use of the English language, you see. It is characterized by omniscience tinged by transcendence and is the truth ever abiding. I said yesterday the scriptures quite often, the slokas fall into a certain thought theme that the seer is expressing. Sometimes the thought theme will take up one sloka, sometimes it will take up two, or in the case of earlier, from sloka 21 through 25, it took up five slokas. So here we have to go on to finish this thought theme. 31, the express sense of the word tvam shines forth as the content of the idea and expression I. So tat tvam asi, that's what I was going to show you. I want to be at this chart right now. I want to take both of these, but this one first. So tat tvam asi, one of these great sayings, you see. Tat tvam asi, there it is, that thou art. So tat is that. We're not telling you what that is. Tvam is I. You see, and then, so going on, it is the awareness blended with the mind that knows itself as the inner organ of perception. So it's a limited mind combined with I, with the true I. And now that we've looked at the samadhis, you can see that true I would be like Purusha on in to Paramatman and Brahman, you know, some of these subtleties that we can look at. And, let's see. Those two go together. We'll save the third one, 32. So 30 and 31, we can take that up and look at this sense of I. Let's look at these Mahavakyas first. You can see there, Daivivak. We just sang Vani Saraswati Vakdevi. You just heard that musically expressed. Vakdevi, the goddess of the word, which we were talking about after all of you adjourned yesterday. Four of us sat here for another hour and had another class. And basically we're talking about Divine Mother and how she is in everything, right on down to the particles of a letter. How she's the power in everything. She's the power of understanding right now, the words I am speaking. Do you understand the words that are coming out of my mouth? See? As I saw in a movie once. Somebody was trying to explain to someone else, you see. You understand the words that are coming out of my mouth, but he didn't say you can understand them because Divine Mother is in every one of them. You know, she's the power to understand, to comprehend. Otherwise, we're sitting in a chamber of the mind here, and what are we doing by listening to a teacher explicate and transmit and so forth, all of that. We're here and we're understanding what he says for the most part. Some of them concepts are a little abstruse and we're getting used to it, but that is the power of comprehension in you is her, you see. And that would be evinced by here, Bhakti Mukti Ganam Dehi, may she bestow devotion, liberation, and knowledge upon us. Also, Saham, she I am. So, Aham, Brahmasmi, up here, I am Brahman, has this concomitant in the Shakti realm, a she I am, Saham. So, why? Because she's that power in every little thing. But most cognized best through the word. So, I'm saying here, aham brahmasmi, and these slokas here that we just read, 30 and 31. So there's tattvamasi. Top quote here, at the height of all levels of the wisdom word and infused with Divine Mother's own power of penetration and dissolution, the great sayings of Sanatana Dharma, the eternal religion of India, assist aspiring beings in destroying the mind's assumed ignorance and attaining the incomparable spiritual station of non-duality. So, fairly quick way to get through the word to wisdom. That is, even a pundit or a scholar or a great intellectual, if they use words right in their language, can arrive at high understanding. But then it's going to take a more subtle turn to penetrate through the understanding of things physical, savitarka, right, and get to the savichara level, where you're beginning to put together the objects with the thoughts. It's funny how people don't do that in this day and age, as if they're somehow separate from each other. But they're not only connected, one has come out of the other. But if you get caught in a sort of 4,320,000,000 year evolutionary cycle with no return, evolution only, then that's the way you begin to think. 15,000,000 year march of the hominidae across the physical world, you see, and that's all that exists, with just some end somewhere. So you're going to have to look for the source to all of this, particularly intelligence and consciousness, which is not found in animals and many humans, unfortunately. You're going to have to look for the source of that in the seers and in the great realized souls, who are telling you again and again that that's maybe true what they're saying about evolution, although highly speculative still, even amongst scientists. But there are four other lands inside of you. I ask you, where are the kingdoms of heaven within? I saw this movie that had these two fighters in it, and Sri Ramakrishna described it. A Muslim wrestler and a Hindu wrestler came together, but one of them comes out, and you know, the crowd's cheering for him, and he goes, it's like this false ego, right? It's all God, not me. And the other comes out and just goes like this. So that's the kingdom of heaven. He's gotten in touch with his ideal, his ishtam is inside, and he's got humble dedication to it. And the other is all show and glorification. It's outside and can't be proved. The inside must be proved too, though. So I'm saying one of the best ways to prove it is to propitiate the Divine Mother of the universe. Who said that? The great master, Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. We must propitiate the Divine Mother of the universe. And she likes very much wisdom words, we found. Sacrifice of goats and buffaloes, she doesn't really prefer that. So those gross ritualists that are killing animals can give that up, you see, for the most part. But she will come straight to you if you have love for her. If you can't know her yet and have that kind of love for her, then appease her with some wisdom. She likes that. She likes to see. She's the mother of wisdom, mother of the word. So she'll get attracted to you that way. Sort of like shooting a flare up when you're lost at sea. They're the four Mahavakyas. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. It couldn't be anything more straightforward and non-dual than that. It's like saying I am my father or one in Christendom. I am Atma Brahma, this self is Brahman. So that's a little bit more qualified dualistic, because you're saying, as it were, there are two things. There's a self and there's Brahman. But this self is Brahman is leading it toward the non-dual. The flavor in them is wonderful to contemplate. Pragyanam Brahman. Brahman is pure consciousness. I'll just skip both of the other two and just say, well, what is it? Or what it is. See, it's pure consciousness. Or as Buddha said before he passed away, Pragyaparam. They say he didn't believe in God and so forth, and make that kind of premature conclusion, but he called himself Pragyaparam, or called divine reality Pragyaparam, supreme intelligence. And he named himself Buddha, so that's after the Bodhi, which is intelligence. Tat tomasi, that thou art, is what we were just hearing about from this great rishi, Antaratamas, in 30 and 31. The express sense of the word tat has maya for its adjunct. It is causeless cause of all the worlds. So everything comes from a word. Who said that?
Jesus.
In the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God. The Word was God. It is characterized by omniscience, tinged with transcendence, and is truth ever abiding. Tinged with transcendence, I wanted to show you this after the break. In fact, the break should happen now. We'll come back, take these other great Advaitic sentences, which are in the Upanishads, look at some of the qualified non-dual ones and some of the Divine Mother ones. And, of course, some of these stumpers, like, I just met the son of a barren woman. Thank you for your attention. We'll take 15 minutes. Live streaming audience, you may look at these charts while we're absent. Thank you for your attention. Namaste and aloha. Welcome back to our second half of the fourth class of this Dharma visit on the Adhyatma Upanishad. We looked very deeply into yoga's connection with Vedanta via these slokas 29 and 28. And we have found ourselves our way to sloka 30 and 31, which go together again as a sort of thought connection of the rishi who's teaching us here. And talking about tattvamasi and what it means, basically, and then putting that together with other great statements, mahavakyas, and also keeping in mind that Mother Wisdom, that's what Mother Wisdom really is that it's infused with this shakti power, or what Patanjali was calling chit shakti. That chit means thought, highest thought. So, as Vivekananda said, intelligence is the first compound of consciousness, is how he put it. And it happens prior to willpower. So jnana shakti and icha shakti is how we'd call those. So this pure conscious intelligence, timeless and deathless, like shining in streams coming off of the word om, is how we envision that. And we've put out the book Gyanamatra, the wisdom particle, and show how worlds can be dissolved and reformed using those. That would be called dissolution of the mind stream or dissolving the mind stream. All of these are connected in that Mother Wisdom tradition because we are devotees of the Divine Mother of the Universe here at SRV Associations. That is Sharada, Ramakrishna, and Vivekananda, who are all devotees of, known as the avatar of Kali, or Mother Kali avatar, Matri avatar, Mother avatar. Also this particular organization, which is a independent but connected to our Ramakrishna order teachers who taught us the Vedanta, is also coming straight out of Mother Sharada, which is Ramakrishna's wife, because my teacher was initiated by her, and so was our founder, Lex Hickson, was initiated by Swami Nikhilananda in New York, and he was also initiated by Holy Mother. So we have a particular penchant, you might say, for focusing in on that way, Shabda Brahma. You know, Shabda Brahman is the path of God through sound. Does sometimes music, yes, that's part of it, but sound is also the music of the word. And there can be a well-orchestrated symphony of words in philosophy, as you've heard me singing the first half, for instance, but there can also be a sort of monotone, or maybe call it Gregorian chant, kind of simplicity to the word. And that's what these Mahavakyas are about. And we've looked at all four of them already. Aham Brahmasmi, Ayamatma Brahma, Pragyanam Brahma, and Tattvamasi. Those occur in the Upanishads here and there, in the Vedas. So they've grafted those out, you know, and then said, oh, these four really epitomize the Advaita side of Vedanta. And, for instance, I asked a monk once, you know, about the mantra, and he said, oh, we didn't get mantras as monks, we got Mahavakyas. And Mahavakyas aren't something you repeat over and over again like a mantra, you know, which is connected to a form, a divine form, with a formula called mantra, japa practice. That's for purifying the mind. But if you've renounced the world and you've become a monk, then the idea is that probably your mind is already fairly pure. Maybe a few more desires to satisfy for higher things, like being fully enlightened and being the king of the devotees and things like that we've heard. But nonetheless, a Mahavakya could just be repeated once and savored. And that is this beautiful sloka here, where the bliss of the self gets savored both externally and internally. Well, the further internal you go, then the more words become sparing and sparse, and pretty soon you want to be satisfied with just the bare minimum of Mahavakya. In the scriptures, we're actually recalling it to mind last night, and we used to say it all the time, but it's sort of disappeared back into this symphony of words for us, is that we used to say that the man who has samadhi, you know, is so deep into it that it's too much botheration to even open and close the eyes. Too much trouble to lift the eyelids and shut them. So he's just like Shiva looking, or they say like Vishnu, eyes half open and half closed. It's part of the attention on the world, the rest of the attention on God. Or Shiva closes them completely and has all his attention back away from the world. So these pathways and their ishtams are explained well and reached through realization by courting the ishtam or the Ishvara or the Antaryami, see the inner ruler, immortal, seated in the heart. But when everything becomes so simple and so pure and so obvious in philosophy and truth, then you'll, what happened? You will, somebody's been looking at my charts. You will find these very, very trimmed down to the essence statements that are easy to comprehend. However, the Brahma Sutras will take something like Tattvamasi and write chapters on it. So then it gets complex again. Brahma Sutras are something we haven't really taken up in the West yet. Some of the Yoga Sutras are there, but the penchant for Hatha is too strong to make that very, to include very many souls here. And we've looked into some of the Vedanta and some Buddhism and all that, but the Brahma Sutras are one of the Prasthanatrayam, the three great scriptures of spiritual history. They're very hard to understand. They're like Zen koans of Vedanta. And you need a teacher to explain them, because in English they don't even really translate well. So you're going to have to be used to sparsity of words. Silence is the first doorway to yoga anyway, Patanjali says. So you're going to have to quiet not only the restless mind, but the babbling tongue. It's this doorway to yoga. Mauna, it's called. You practice silence. Pretty soon you just pretty much are silent as you move among the world and withdrawn. Cessation, he called it here, or detachment. Of detachment, the fruit is knowledge. Of knowledge, the fruit is withdrawal. Experience of self as bliss leads to peace. Again, peace is the fruit of consummate withdrawal. So it'll be the way of the enlightened soul to become more and more peaceful, more and more silent as a result. It'll be very hard for you to walk up to Jesus or Buddha and ask him to speak. And you have to make an effort to do that. And we saw that with Sri Ramakrishna too. Come out of samadhi and he'd look around and say, who are all these beings? He couldn't even recognize his wife and his beloved Naran, the young Vivekananda, until you gave him some. So, I know a man who sleeps with holy water in a bottle next to him, because that'll bring him back down to earth when he needs to. Just the thought of it would bring it back down out of sleep that's where, you know, too far away from the body. So hard to get back into these dense mechanisms that way. You have to find a way to bring it down. The five elements would be, just the thought of them would be a way of doing that. The final quote here, now that we've looked at all four of these, basically, by Mahavakya Nusudana, inquiry into the meaning of the great sayings, seekers perceive reality. So straight through the word, or the word's offshoots, if you want to say Om is the main word, and then these are would come off of Om. So that's a way of perceiving reality. And I looked and found other great Advaitic statements in the Upanishads. Brahman Satya Jagad Mitya, Brahman alone is real, the world is unreal. We often say about that that people immediately hear the world is unreal and get sad or unhappy or put off, but they forgot to consider the first, Brahman is real. That's the good news, as they say. So, in fact, Brahman is the only reality. So that would might be a way of jumping to the chase there and not even mentioning ignorance and Maya and these unreal things that are what?
Superimpositions.
False superimpositions over Brahman. And that make what look real? Limiting adjuncts. Kevala asti. You alone exist. Swami Vivekananda has said that before. I paraphrase him. He says that when I think so, it is so. I alone am. So when I think that, it is so. That's taking everything back into the one self, not into this individual self among other individual selves. Which would be a feat in itself, they say. Used to say, Sri Ramakrishna would say, Naran, you know, different than all the other devotees around him, see, that they would shrink so much as to slip through the chinks in the net of Maya and get free. But Naran grew so much that he burst the net of Maya. You know, this great soul like that. The master once said to the young Vivekananda, an elephant walks through a village and dogs bark at its heels. Right? Giving him a hint, that's what it's going to be when you hit the world. The village of the world will bark at your heels and there'll be all sorts of clamor. Not only from Americans who, and fundamentalist Christians, but from his own fundamentalist Brahmin priests back in India were criticizing him. They brought him a newspaper once with some more word of his exploits in the West, you know, negative things, some negatives there and there. And he just took a look at it through the fireplace. I usually make an offering of these kinds of things to the fire god, he said. Om Indram Mitram Varuna Agni Matarato Divyaha Sa Sapurna Garutaman. Make the offering of all these to the gods. Because that one, the eternal among non-eternal, the friend of all beings, the lord of the gods, the devourer of death, the fire of yoga, the winged carrier of consciousness, is my God. So even amongst all the gods, you take them and put them back into this oneness. So these Mahavakya or Advaitic statements are well known for that. Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. All this is Brahman. It's a very noble statement to make, but very risky if you don't know what you're talking about. Like green coconut oneness is there. You know, you think that it's all one mass, but when it gets ripe, it turns into five layers. So you have to ripen that before you can say this and actually mean it. Because you're not going to say, renounce objects and all that, and you know, because they're empty, and then return to it and call God an object, or to objectify Brahman. Is not possible. Not only not philosophically incorrect, but it's also not possible to bring Brahman into the world. God's not in the world, the world is in God, as Swamiji used to say. So you have to turn it on its ear, because this is Maya, and Maya makes everything look opposite of what it truly is. So Sri Ramakrishna used to say that this way. He said, the door to truth, the key and the lock turns the opposite way. People are trying to turn it the way they think it'll unlock, but if you want to get to truth, you're going to have to see through Maya and look at everything the opposite of what Maya has proposed. And so the lock, the key goes into the lock and turns the opposite way than most people think. Lex Hickson used to love that saying very much, to as a sort of pronouncement against Maya. Chin matroham, I am pure consciousness, sort of like Pragyanam Brahma. Then ahameva sarvaha, I alone am all this. Kam brahm, all is Brahman. Ahamatma, I am Atman. Sarvosmi, I am all. Asmi, I am. So I gathered these and put them in a sort of trim down, you see, so you can get this, if you want to just walk about saying, Asmi. Who are you? I don't know. Ask me. You know, ask me and I'll tell you. Qualified non-dual statements are very beautiful. I mean, you can't talk about truth unless you come down to the qualified level. You can't speak of truth at this highest level. So Jesus, Buddha, and Ramakrishna are dwelling at this highest level. They're going to have to come down from these centers to these centers to explain these abstruse, often abstruse truths to you, and therefore you'll be able to understand them and use them, Mother Wisdom, to elevate your consciousness and deepen it, intensify it. So some of them are aham etatna, I am not this. Anaham tvam, not I, but thou. That was actually Sri Ramakrishna. I only knew a few English words, and a few of those evidently were those. Not I, but thou. Not I, but thou. And he gave the story of the calf and how it's slaughtered, and then the skin's cut from it, and when it's alive, it's bleating, why me, why me, and so forth. And as it refines, it gets on the loom, and it gets beaten by the, after the skin's taken off, it's being purified, then it just goes, tohu, tohu, which means, not I, not thou, not I and thou. It loses its ego, and it loses its body. So the different levels of that are explained by him in the death of this poor calf. It's like the death of the ego. Ishvara Prayatna, it is God's will. It's like some of our Sufi friends go, Inshallah. See, if God so wills it, it's kind of their main saying. So we would say, yes, Ishvara Prayatna, it is God's will. And Shokamayata, for God so desired. You can see why they're qualified, because God has no desire. But as it were, just a saying in English, tongue-in-cheek. Niranjanaham, I am spotlessly pure. There was one of Sri Ramakrishna's devotees named Swami Niranjanananda, who's, unlike his brothers, was very tall, like some of the men who are coming here lately to SRV, very tall. As they call them, the Vedanta Society of the Ents now. And there's everyone's walking around having to bow their head at arches and downstairs in the shrine. Came up the shrine for meditation this morning, and one of them was walking around just like this. He was not raising his head. Just, what a humble person. No, no, I'm actually being very careful not to bump my head. Ekoham Bahusham. May I, the one, become many. So you can turn it back away from oneness toward the many. So it's either involution or it's evolution, isn't it? And if it's evolution, you have to be very careful to man the stations and master them so that you can return to those stations in the same way you left. And that's a spiritual evolution or cosmic involution as compared to just a scientific or physical evolution. There has to be a return. There's a chain of evolutes outward, Lord Kapila says, and there's also a reverse chain of evolutes inward. Sanchara prati sancharaha, he said. In three words, he just said the truth about relativity and included everything in both sweeps in it. There's a chain of evolutes outward, there's also a chain of evolutes inward. And one of the earliest philosophies of India. And what is the chain of evolutes inward? Some 24, 25 cosmic principles and fives. We have to come along in every age and remind everyone of this and describe it to them and let certain souls avail themselves of these tattvas, these stations that consciousness mans and gives up. See? And so that they can do that on an involutionary scale. And not just get caught in some river inward that's samsara river, see, leading to an ocean of suffering and delusion and rebirth, but get onto that river of Kaivalya. Their souls are moving back to their original freedom after having tasted a little bit of what relativity is like. See. Pretty soon they'll see no difference between reality and relativity. It'll be one thing to them. But again, just like saying all this is Brahman, you have to be careful how to understand that. Now look at the let's stay in the vein and look at the great sayings of the Shakyas below. Bhakti Mukti Ganam Dehi, May she bestow devotion and liberation on us. Bhakti, mukti, jnanam, dehi. So bhakti is devotion, mukti is liberation, and jnanam is wisdom. And prabuddha sarvata tishtat. Get the ever awakened. You know, some of our Ramakrishna order has this beautiful literary arm, you know, called the Prabuddha Bharata. So awakened India, using the ancient name for India, I mean, instead of India, Bharat, in the ancient eternal land. So we find many beautiful Vedantic thought bombs in there, and articles that are pleasing to your philosophical palate and which lead to a higher realization. When you see the mother wisdom in them particularly. Tavaivaham, I am thine alone. I am thine alone. So Shaktas like to think of that. I give myself entirely to the Divine Mother of the universe. Let her do what she wants with me. Sri Ramakrishna used to say that, the mother kitten takes the kitten and sometimes puts it near the hearth, sometimes puts it in the sandbox, sometimes puts it on the back porch, and sometimes puts it on the master's bed. But it only mews, waiting for her to come back and take her somewhere else. So that's this completely self-surrendered attitude of the devotee of the Divine Mother of the universe to his or her ideal. And Saham, she I am. So just like when there's any ideal and the one practicing meditation on the ideal and the one who is separate from the ideal, that's the Triputi, then you're going to merge that all into one eventually. So there's Shakta Advaitavada. It's a path in India, which means the Advaita according to the mother path. So you probably end up with a saying like that, she, I am. Now, having shown that, let's move quickly to this. It's, you might say, a step out. I wouldn't say a step down, but it definitely refers to mantra instead of Mahavakya. I've already drawn a sort of difference for you in that way. Mantras are something you repeat over and over again, hopefully with a lot of heart in them and a lot of devotion for your ishtam, making the connections inside, and meditating there will help purify the mind over time. The mantra's got scrubbing bubbles that go down to the psyche and do their work, sort of like the Mr. Clean commercials of the 60s, you see. I can sing those for you if you want.
That's okay.
Me and my brother have contests about that. Oh, you remember the music to that game by Mattel, that, you know, Mousetrap? Yes, Mousetrap. So we'd play it on the violin or sing it. I not only remember the music, I remember the words. Mr. Clean will make your whole house and everything that's in it. Mr. Clean, Mr. Clean. Oh, I forgot that one. Why did you remind me? Oh, talk about lower mantras. But anyway, mantra will do those scrubbing bubbles on your psyche. And it'll churn up stuff at first. We've had whole seminars and retreats on mantra, and there's going to be a series of classes on the YouTube soon that has everything from soup to nuts about the mantra. I think it's time that that get put out. Because mantra is really probably the main way that the Westerners are going to get free. This is only for a few, probably, and it has to be entertained deeply. Other ways, bring salvation and are slower, and but enlightenment, full enlightenment, and that kind of thing, what they call mukti or moksha, really comes about from a complete withdrawal, as the Rishi is saying here, that brings about this peace of mind that settles the mind about the unreality of the world. Brahman Satya Jagat Mitya, right? There's just no doubt anymore about that. And that brings a peace of mind that will cause no return to old climes again. So here on the sacred beaches of mantra science chart, you see bija of transcendent, bija of wisdom, bija of purification, bija of abundance, and bija of insight, and bija of transformation. That is, Om Aim Hrim Shrim Krim Klim. Oftentimes, we will even sing those kinds of things. Ya Devi Sarvabhuteshu Vishnumayati Shabdita Namastasyai 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 Ya Devi Namo Namaha Ya Devi Namo Namaha Ya Devi Namo Namaha Ya Devi Namo Namaha Devi Namaha, she who exists as all these seeds in all beings, and their origin in the great mind of God. She'll give these seeds to Lord Brahma, Lord Vishnu, Lord Shiva, and so forth, so that they can project, sustain, and withdraw. Their bijams, is it there? Shh. Don't say it, but it's home. Very careful to say the seed. Bijam hum, that's destruction. You see, that's dissolution of it all. Shiva has that in spades. And we'll use it. So everything comes from a word, as Jesus said, so it's going to end with that word too. That's the origin of everything. It's in the beginning was the word was with God, and finally it was God. So those are three different things. That's a great triputi to meditate on, what Jesus told John. So these bijams then have these great power in them. These are the seed words. So it's good to know them. Holy Mother said, when Sri Ramakrishna was alive, he taught me all the mantras and bijams and all the deities that they connect with. Because she was going to be initiating thousands of people in her life and then millions after she passed through her channels. Now up to 6 million now are initiated by these great bijams in the Ramakrishna order alone. What to speak of other great orders like Shankara order and so forth. Those that are doing great work for the benefit of living beings. So there you see, I had to think of them because it's not really in many books. And when you find them in books, has the author been given them? Has he meditated on them? Or is it just information? Or is there a mixture in there? But here you see, from the tradition, Om, representative of timeless awareness and the medium for absolute and relative. So out of the word will come everything and it will return into the word. I see that's why this has two petals here, the Agya chakra, you see, outgoing and ingoing petal, as it were, one for evolution out of consciousness and one for involution of consciousness. So not that consciousness ever moves, but it assumes stations. It's all pervasive in the whole thing, like sweetness and sugarcane juice. You can't find it. A bit of that juice that's not sweet, you see. So Brahman is there and everything, it doesn't move. But as far as relativity goes, the first thing out the gate, conditioned awareness or intelligence, you see, a slightly conditioned awareness, then it'll move out through that. Out means down, really. Down. The chakras, in other words. Bija of wisdom, I'm. It's the herald of spiritual wisdom. So it's really her, Saraswati's, main bija, I'm. Om, they say, is the word of Brahman. If Brahman has a word, it would be that. Hrim is really the bijams for Kali and Durga, more of a tantric flavor. Implement of refinement and neutralizer of negativity. Oh, so back up to I'm. It's the subtle key of creation, too, that is projection. So Hrim will neutralize negativity, which is why Kali and Durga are often seen in battles against negativity, and maybe in cremation grounds, you know, where souls leave the body. They're associated with that shift of consciousness after death to higher regions and the destroying of karmas via a bijam like that. So if you use Hrim in your mantra, you're getting very close to the source of perfection, and getting rid of all subtle imperfections on the way. Bijam abundance is Shrim. It's the harbinger of quality and quantity, Shrim. You would probably connect it with Lakshmi or Narayani, Vishnu's consort. Harbinger of quality and quantity, a bestower of mature fulfillment. That's why a lot of beings worship the goddess of good fortune, Lakshmi and Nara and Narayan, Vishnu and his consort. They want fulfillment in the highest and most fullest of ways. So they will get that and have all their desires fulfilled and reach the highest state of enlightenment in their Shakti path. That would be Dharma, Artha, Kama, and then Moksha. Ending it. Yeah. You get everything that way. Krim, oracle of infallible omniscience, revealer of eternal perfection. See, probably you could hook that up with Savitri. There's another very profound manifestation of the goddess. Oracle of infallible omniscience and revealer of eternal perfection. And Klim, Bija of transformation. It's that which gives you the impetus to revolt against the world. See, there's this kind of revolution of the spirit inside that's going on. And it's also a weapon for regeneration. Once you extract yourself from unhealthy and unholy things, even admixtures, then you feel some things have been ripped out by the roots and you don't feel full, so you're going to have to regenerate. So that mantra, that bijam in the mantra will help you do that. And there are the four major Mahavakyas again, with the image of Shankara there, which is in the garden of the Vedanta Society of Sacramento, where our wonderful Swami Sradhananda lived when I used to go there and speak and play sacred music for the congregation there back in the 80s and 90s when he was alive. There's a beautiful statue full size of Shankara in the garden there at the Vedanta Society of Sacramento. And that's been shown here. And out of his mudras or in his scriptures are coming these great Mahavakyas, which you saw here. And we've already said them once today, so we better not say them again. Careful. Just meditate on them. This is all in accordance with 30 and 31. So we're taking in today's class two slokas, and we took three yesterday. So we're making some headway. Don't worry. And let's go on to see Brahman's subtlety then, which is this chart that's been there before you in the first half. The Kaivalya Upanishad says this. This is one of those minor Upanishads like the one we're studying here. Kaivalya Upanishad is very... It's gotten a little bit more exposure than some of these others, but in fact, it's in a book called Minor Upanishads put out by the Ramakrishna Order. Paramahamsa Upanishad and Kaivalya Upanishad and some others. Mukta Upanishad. That which is the Supreme Brahman, the soul of all, the great support for the universe, called Ati Sukshma, subtler than the most subtle, and eternal, that is thyself, and thou art that. So a good segue out of the Mahavakyas and the Bijams, so forth, into where they lead. Subtleties of Brahman, you might say, because there are many, many words there that seem to point straight to Brahman, if not designate the inseparable oneness of all of these with Brahman. And you would probably start here then at the bottom of this chart and look at Sakshi, which is witness. Now, the thing about the witness then is that there's something it's witnessing. But in Brahman, that would disappear. So the subtlety there is there's still a subtle sense of two-ness. You are the witness, but you could even say, if you look out, you see the ego below you, and you're the supreme ego. And if you look further in, or to the highest, then you see the paramahamkara, the supreme self. And that's That's like a firefly flying into a bonfire. You know, it's just, if you go there, then there's just no two-ness at all. It's indescribable. You have to use metaphors like that. Masi is a bonfire. That's it. He's having Savitarka, and then he's having Savichara, and then he's having Sananda. And he's saying, I think I like my moth bliss, just looking at the bonfire from a distance. Then he gets Sasmita. Well, maybe it's better if I go towards it. Poof. It's all she wrote. So the words there, sakshi, on either side of the chart, I've put these sayings from the Upanishads. It's the cognizer of the presence and absence of knower, knowledge, and knowable. Both the cognizer and of the presence and absence. Okay, so even subtle dualities are seen by it, which is not true of the gross ego. The gross dualities are seen by it, and even when they're seen, they're not known. They're not known how to be the producers of pain and to be the doorways out of pain, both. If you suffer, you go for pleasure, go back for suffering. Eventually you should get the idea, this should be your teacher, that the dualities are telling you, transcend me, if you want out of this constant tennis match, you see. Want to heal your sore neck. On the other side, self-luminous witness of all beings and phenomena in relativity. That's sakshi, two descriptions for sakshi. The Mundaka Upanishad says, as the spider emits and withdraws its web, as herbs sprout from the soil of the earth, and as hair grows on the head without any effort, so from the imperishable being the universe springs forth. You probably would still somewhere in the qualified non-dual level there, because there's cause and effect going on, even with these very fine metaphors, and you know, you see the subtle distinction of witness. But it's definitely, they talk about the 4 feet of Brahman, 4 feet of Brahman, how it expresses itself. See, so you might say that this is like the back left foot. Then kutasta is another word that we hear and must entertain. Kato Upanishad says about it, the Atman, hidden in all beings, reveals itself not to all, but is seen only by the seers of the subtle through their refined and pointed intellect. Kutasta really means kind of a underlying substratum. That's, and also the implication is connected by a thread. So there's this thread running through everything, and then the pearls are held together by it. The two descriptions on one side are Kutasta's undifferentiated presence in and as the intelligence of all beings. So you're going from a cognizer to a look at something that's really innate or inherent in the self. That is this supreme intelligence, pragyaparam if you want. On the other side, intelligence residing in all that is unreal, from Lord Brahma down to an ant. Or, as Antaroptimus told us yesterday, from Lord Brahma down to
clumps of grass.
You know. So that is the underlying substratum in everything. And if you can see through, push aside the green scum from the pond, you can see yourself, Ramakrishna said. That's what you'll need to do in order to see this underlying substratum. It's also described very well in Patanjali's Yoga, and as in Samkhya Yoga too. So some 5 or 6 proofs of Purusha, it's called. Then there's Antaryami. I can't even say the word without wanting to sing about it. Such a beautiful word. So you have here this beautiful verse.
Jaya Purushottama Anupama Samyama Jaya Jaya Antaryami Karatara Sadara Nakaduka Varana Jaya Rama Krishna Namah.
Jaya Jaya Antaryami says, Jaya Purushottama, the Supreme Soul, Anupama Samyama, Jaya Jaya Antaryami. It's this beautiful Sri Ramakrishna Jayashtaka, it's called. These eight verses written by Devendranath Mazumdar. And you'll find that in the Jaima collection of CDs. So basically how it's translated in English, reverent salutations to the one whose renunciation is matchless and who accomplished severe austerities for the good of humanity, to that best of avatars who is the inner controller immortal abiding eternally in the soul, we bow down in humble obeisance. So Antaryami is this inner ruler immortal seated in the soul. I first heard that English definition from one Mr. Morosi, who was the leader of the sub-center of Vedanta Society in Honolulu when we lived on Oahu. And we went there and my teacher said, go help Mr. Morosi. So we were on the north shore of Oahu for a while. So we began going to Honolulu every Sunday and manning the Vedanta library and helping him with that. His wife and he had been devotees of Ramakrishna for like 60 years under the initiation of Swami in Seattle at the time.
Vividishananda,
right, Swami Vividishananda, because Swami Bhaskarananda is now, is still in Seattle, although he's very elderly. But Swami Vividishananda was their guru. And so when I was sitting in the Vedanta class there, and then I heard Mr. Morosi would kind of read from the scripture, and then every once in a while he'd look up and take off his glasses, sort of like the sloth, you know. And he would say, inner ruler immortal seated in the heart, that's the Antaryami. It's a very beautiful, it stuck with me a long time, sort of like the sorrowless ocean of light or something. You know. Yeah, Patanjali describes Brahman. So Antaryami is mentioned at the last verse. Otherwise you have
Bhavavaya Panjana Purusha Niranjana Rati Pati Ganjana Kari Yatiyana Ranjana Mana Mana Kandana Maya Bhava Ranjana Hari Jaya Bhava Bandana Hari Jaya Rama Krishna Namami Jaya Rama Krishna Namami.
And it rolls on like that. I haven't sung it for ages, but we used to sing it all the time and Jaima music tours, and so it rolls on and on like that through a series of verses which are quite beautiful. That comes to my mind every time I think of the word Antaryami, which here is described in these two ways. Interwoven in all, like the thread which runs through a string of jewels, it is the inner ruler immortal seated in the hearts of all and free from all differentiations. India has taken a long time and a lot of effort to use words, especially in Sanskrit, to describe to us the indescribable. They put forth that effort because words have the power of mother in them, so why should we turn away from them just because something's too wordy or something? But whether it's too wordy or not shouldn't be the point. It's whether it's higher wisdom is in the words or lower wisdom. If higher wisdom's in it, the more words the better. In fact, that can deluge your ego and wash it away. It's called the immersion method, or sometimes it's called the inundation method. There's the sieve method, which you just throw a little of that wisdom along a certain tract into the ego. But the inundation method is just make it give up. And then you can use the sponge method later to squeeze out the mind, you see, and keep what's essential. But you might not get what's essential in the sieve method. It might still be waiting back there in the ocean, you see, working its way toward that drain. So squeeze it out later and get the essence. But inundate your mind with this dharma, with these teachings. And you'll find that it's also said in the Svetashvatara Upanishad about Antaryami, that indivisible soul is as subtle as a hair point, divided and subdivided hundreds of times, yet is potentially infinite. It is to be known beyond gender, whatever body it assumes it identifies with. So it's got that kind of lightning-like freedom to move in these stations of consciousness and abandon them. Like Sri Krishna says about scents blown from flowers. He says, I'm like the scents blown from flowers. Nobody knows where I come from. They don't know how I move, how I get there, and when I depart. That's Antaryami. It's very much associated, too, with the principle of Ishtam or Ishvara. Antaryami and Ishvara. That is this, one meditates on that as the highest concept the mind can possibly hold or comprehend. Then there's this word, Pratyagatman. The Swami came up to me in India and said, what's your name? Pratyagatananda. What? Pratyagatananda. Could you slow that down for me, Swami? He said, have you heard of the Pratyagatman? I said, oh, yeah, the Atman Pratya. Yes, now I get it, see, and it's full of bliss, right? Yes. So the description there, the entity thou, which is in the nature of pure conscious awareness, remember, thou, it's like in that thou art, there it is. The entity thou, that which is the nature of pure conscious awareness, so it's that, right to the point of that thou art. Also, a homogeneous mass of consciousness free from all
limiting adjuncts.
Limiting adjuncts, that's right. The Kaivalya Upanishad said it nicely then when it says, that which is the supreme Brahman, the soul of all, the great support of the universe, called Ati Sukshma, subtler than the most subtle and eternal, that is thyself and that thou art. You'll find this chart then to be of a great benefit to you to contemplate. Sometimes that's what you'll hear when you sing. Aham nirvikalpo nirakara rupo vibhutvachya sarvatra sarvendriyanam. Acha sangatam naiva muktir nameya chirananda rupa shivoham shivoham. No form or fancy. The all-pervading am I. I exist, yet I am beyond the senses. I exist everywhere. Neither salvation am I, nor anything that can be known. I am pure consciousness and bliss. I am Shiva. I am Shiva. So that was the last of the six stanzas on Nirvana by Adi Shankaracharya, and the one that really epitomized best this speaking about samadhi that we're into, along with the peace and bliss and the truth that follows it, as Swamiji said in his poem. Wake up the note, the song that had its birth far off, where worldly taint could never reach, in mountain caves and glades of forest deep, whose calm no sigh for lust or wealth or gain could ever break. Where rolled the stream of knowledge, truth, and the bliss that follows both. Sing high that note, sannyasin bold, say,
Om Tat Sat Om.
Yes. Again, in my early touring days with Jaima Music, we would go to the Chicago summer monastery of the Vedanta Society there, out in Ganges, Michigan, of all things. You know, I never found out why somebody named it Ganges outside of Chicago, but there we would go, and some of the American monks were there, and we'd go sit with them in the morning in the shrine, and at the end of the meditation, every day they would recite the entire Sangha Sannyasa and all 13 verses. And it's very beautiful to hear all of them doing it at once. Yes?
Did you, maybe I missed it, that Kaivalya Upanishad quote under Pratyagatha?
Mm-hmm.
Did you want to let the live stream see that one?
Yeah. Oh, this quote.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you. Because I thought I had got them all, but here, let me go back to it and read that to you. That is the substratum, the bliss, the indivisible consciousness in whom the three worlds dissolve. Realizing the Atman abiding in the heart, partless, secondless, beyond existence and non-existence, one attains the Paramatman, Kaivalya Upanishad. So again, they're making this effort to give these very profound descriptions. You'll have to school yourself a little bit in words, but you had to do that in English, and you have to do that in other languages if you want to go to other countries. So if you want to go to the country of spirituality, this great country inside, you're going to have to school yourself in some of this ancient Sanskrit, which is the best language ever to speak about spirituality and its realization, and also very high philosophy, not just debate philosophy or speculation philosophy, but a philosophy that, when you put it together with the devotion of the heart, clears the whole field of doubt, destroys fear, and puts death in its own grave, as my teacher used to say. So you'll get that, and you'll get a combination of all rivers, like Tantra coming from one direction with its deification, and Vedanta coming from the other direction with its not this, not this, I am that combination. And then yoga coming up, you see, as the prana energy of everything, and showing you how to practice, and Samkhya showing you what the basis is of all these stations that consciousness mans, right on down to the five senses. You'll get that. And then you'll have earlier manifestations and expressions of it, like Buddhism and all its forms. So adept and adequate at explaining your true nature as Buddha nature, and least inhibited and encumbered by anything denominational, just very to the point. So India and its philosophy, if you want to call it that, has this and more. Very well evinced there in that final chant. What it reminds me of is when it says, in whom the three worlds dissolve, and then it goes on to say it is partless and secondless. See, so yesterday I started off the class saying Vedanta Siddhanta Niruktiresha Brahmaiva Jivaham Sakalam Jagat Cha Akandarupa Stitireva Moksho Brahmad Vitiye. So that's one of their, might as well have been put on this chart, one without a second. I don't think it's on there, but it would be another to add to that collection. It is one without a second. So it sort of puts duality and appearances of Maya all in its place as being limiting adjuncts or false superimpositions, things that you want to get beyond or get them behind you so that you can encounter this one indivisible homogeneous mass of pure conscious awareness. And it works well in English. We're very fortunate. That's probably another reason why Vivekananda came here, is to bring that forth into a language that was well developed enough so that we would have words for many of the great principles and ideologies that are found in these different darshanas of India. There's a few we're missing, but those are like revelations to us, and revelations are good. Like I said, prana is missing, tanmatras are missing, samskaras are missing. Right away you have three words like that that you have a hard time putting into English, and even a harder time explaining to a culture that's never seen them, never encountered or entertained them in their thinking process. Of course, first you have to have a thinking process. And that's going to take some of this innate intelligence to cultivate. We chanted that this morning, right? The Atman is realized by knowledge, moderation, austerity, and veracity, all cultivated constantly. That's a nice little formula there. So knowledge, the first one would be that you have to entertain this higher knowledge. The lower knowledge is only satisfies for a little while. Who said that? Swami Vivekananda. You'll see it at the foot of every email you receive from SRV. It's kind of a motto down there, you see. The lower knowledge will only satisfy for a little while. Eventually you'll have to go on to encounter and contemplate these higher teachings. They're really fulfilling, very satisfying. And they won't leave you in the lurch in the end, what to speak of along the way. You'll be well shored up. Well, in 15 minutes, we've reached the next sloka, which we can take. Well, let's at least take it for meditation on what is to come in October when I return here in about seven weeks only, I think, to enact and perform the Durga Puja with all of you again. I don't know how many Durga Pujas we've done, but we do once a year, one a year, a big three-hour worship with 16 articles, and as I learned it in India and modified it and adapted it for Americans in SRV Association. So we'll come back in October for that. Again, this is the last class, formal class, that will be live streamed in this visit. Next weekend we're on seminar, talking about the illumined teacher and the sincere and qualified preceptor, guru-shishya, it's called, relationship. Four big intense classes on that, Saturday, Sunday. So we won't be online for that weekend, nor the weekend afterward, which is the weekend I return to Hawaii. But the weekend after that, we'll start into another series live streaming. So for the next 2 weekends, you can contemplate it, and you can also contemplate in the interim this next sloka, 32. Only through the exclusion of Maya and Avidya do God and Jiva equal one Supreme Spirit. It's divine poetry. Only through the exclusion of Maya and Avidya, that is this name, form, time, space, causation, appearance that's being thrown and foisted upon you all the time, and Avidya, ignorance, the first of all yogic kleshas, ignorance of the true self, do God and equal one Supreme Spirit. Otherwise, they don't. It's like taking both duality and Advaita to task. That is pseudo-Advaita. Say, all is one, green coconut style. But if Maya and Avidya are still influencing your tongue when you say that in any way, then it's not true. It might as well be not true for you and for those listening. So you're really going to have to know that, become a knower of Brahman. How do you become a knower of Brahman? By first, akamahata, having no desires. Two, avijjana, leading a pure life. Three, stotriya, knowing the essence of these scriptures. And four, then you can become a knower of Brahman. That's how the great teachers do it. So it's a very condensed and easy formula, again, for testing yourself on your declaration that I'm an Advaita Vedantist, see, or I'm a Zen Buddhist, or I'm a realized soul. These things have to be run by both monk and householder. You see, there are great householder yogis amongst us that make the world experience the spring season, you see, all the time. Basant, it's always spring in their presence. It's always a mart of bliss that's flowing around them. So that's the first sentence. Only through the exclusion of Maya and Avidya do God and Jiva equal one Supreme Spirit, the impartite being. It is consciousness and bliss as indicated by the seers. If you want the final dindima again, or siddhanta, it's just consciousness and bliss. And then those are the two best words that you can borrow, Chaitanya and Ananda. See, if you want to explain it in words, as close as words can say. What can I tell you in 10 minutes about that sloka? But maybe to review this for a few minutes. The disappearance of ignorance kind of idea. Because remember, yesterday I showed you that progress of spirituality, how to progress in it. But here you see it put in a way of two actual paths that reach at an apex, like put in triangular form. In this way of saying, I have to see this here, there have been many beautiful quotes here, but you can see that this reason I selected it was, it's the absence of maya and avidya. In that, then you'll be able to declare Brahman as one. So here's avidya, right at the root. You might call this mula avidya. It's just a cloud of unknowing. It's a curtain of nescience. It's there when the three gunas begin to operate. It's just like a cloak thrown over everything for the ego and the soul when it first thinks about entering into an individual existence. It's just like natural that's there, like scum on a pond. You see, nobody knows where it comes from, and you have to part it somehow. So it's just the nature of form to cover formlessness. That's called
Devarta.
False superimposition. Yeah. That's the nature of form. So they never did look upon form very kindly in Vedanta because it covers. And what else does it do?
Distorts.
So you don't get a good look at yourself in a mixture of part foam and part water. Is that how I look? So you need to get a clear view of yourself, and then hope you'll say, well, that's better. And not say, oh, that's worthless, cloud it up again. Those people who have ignorance, they get a partial view of themselves and it's distorted, and that's the end of their spiritual practice. Sort of like using the mantra, and these scrubbing bubbles bring up this residue of karma. And they say, oh, is that me? Well, but you have to have a teacher there to say, oh, that's not you, that's just your past actions, some residue. Just wait a while, keep using the mantra, and that will get purified. Then you'll get this clear sun behind the clouds. You know, let the clouds go by, the Buddhists say, in your meditation before you get this vast, boundless, infinite sky of awareness you can look at, which is, you know, also suggested by words like those. So if you come up from ignorance, here on this directory, you start with Dharma. This is a more spiritual way to proceed, you might say. The actual aspirant is coming here. He'd give me the teachings. Then he says, I need more holy company, satsanga. Now I need to study, swadhyaya. I need to contemplate what I study, manana. I need to do austerities so that what I contemplate from my study will get implemented into my being. And anything that I'm not understanding here will be cleared away by my austerity. Because satjena labhyastapasahi saatma samyagnena brahmacharyena nityam. Tapasa, austerity, is going to be one of those things that you will need to have. And after that, then, sadhana goes forth in full motion. So you have a spiritual life, you have a practice, and you're engaged with it 100%. You're not dragging your feet, hopefully, because this should have cleared all that away. Then you get some padyate, attainment. That's recommended highly in the Gospel of Sri Ramakrishna by the Master. He said, you must get some spiritual attainment under your belt. It's sort of like getting your qualifications ready. When I was teaching at the prison Thursday, and you know, there were poor souls in there that were sitting in 120-degree cells in the daytime, coming to my class, and they're all red, sweaty, telling me about it. One man said, how do I get rid of karma? And I said, well, let's go look at the bookshelf. So went back to the Vedanta bookshelf there, and all these books, there was not a copy of Karma Yoga by Vivekananda there, so I couldn't give him that. But I saw this abridged version of the Gospel of Ramakrishna, and I said, read this every day. See, it's like Moses saying, you know, hearing from God, you know, I have a headache. Take 2 stone tablets and call me later. So that's what I did for this man with a prison headache, you see. gave him the gospel of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, and he can take that to his cell, and he did. He took it with him, and he'll read every day. So in there you'll find teachings like that. Get some attainment under your belt. This is a kind of way that I've put together from looking at my own sadhana period of how it happened. And finally, some transcendence will come to you, para. We'll start next visit's class on Adhyatma Upanishad, maybe with this chart. We can pick it right up and do all these quotes. But just to finish up right now, there's a more non-religious way to proceed. Starts with excitement. Sri Ramakrishna, or Sri Sharadadevi says, the happiness of the world is transitory. The less you become attached to the world, the more you enjoy the peace of mind. So it's a kind of excitement that's infusing everything, probably even the excitement for Dharma and the excitement of holy company, but you'll get over it, you see, and you'll get down to work, basically. So work here means this kind of sukla or happiness, like sattva that attends. Some joy comes, mudita. Shall we sing it? Prema mudita manase kaho rama rama rama. A kind of mudita that comes from that. And then some wisdom begins to distill. Like Swami Vivekananda said, all of work in life really should lead to knowledge. That's its point. Or like Vashishta sang yesterday, you know, if you reach the end of your life and contentment hasn't dawned on you, then something went awry earlier. It's, in other words, this contentment should be a natural concomitant of living life, not the opposite. So something really went awry on your path through your young. I'm going to say, when I look back at my friends in high school and college, if I ever met them in later life, many of them had burnt themselves out by the time they were 30. I was very shocked to see them when they were more vibrant in their high school, and see them and their life is practically over by one means or another, either by drinking or smoking or that intoxicants, or by working too hard in the world without anything to shore them up. See, it's longevity. These people that have longevity and keep their Shiva essence, they keep their youth and are able to store up their energy, and let it out just in increments for the higher good, that in the end have this mature life. And they don't look back on it, with any regrets and so forth. So it's a beautiful saying by Lord Vashishta, and it proves true here. Then some contentment should come out of that. Tripti, a nice word, tripti, contentment. Peace should come out of that, and equanimity from that, samatva. And then bliss, ananda. So you, in this trajectory, in this triangle, this left-hand side of this triangle, you don't really see anything that's that religious, you see, or philosophical. It's just like qualities, isn't it? Excitement, happiness, joy, wisdom, contentment, peace. It's the kind of a way what people will proceed. And if they follow it rightly, and these quotes actually nurture you along. We'll look at those on my next visit. But this way is definitely, I am a committed devotee, I'm following the traditional way, and this is kind of the way it goes, and this is what should happen. So that at the end of my life, I will be able to look back and feel fully content and have attainment under my belt, under my spiritual belt, so that I can exit the body consciously, and if I do come back for another life, come back in wisdom, free of what? This cloud of unknowing, or that people fall into at the time of their death. And implied in all this, of course, is a lot of this. You have to have a spiritual ideal, you have to have a higher goal to reach for, and you have to have an example of that. Holy company would rather be sort of an example of that. Put all those things together, and there shouldn't be hard for you to dispel ignorance and realize the truth in this life. So, Brahmanandam Paramasukadam Kevalam Gyanamurtim Dandvaititam Gagana Sadrisham Tat Vamashadi Laksham Ekam Nicham Vimalamachalam Sarvadi Sakshibudam Bhavatitam Trigunarahitam Sadgurum Tannamami. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi. We salute the leader of our souls, through whose grace our ignorance is dispelled, who is beyond good and bad, pleasure and pain, life and death, and all other pairs of opposites. We recognize that one as the only witness to the changing phenomena of this universe. May we through that grace go beyond darkness and delusion and realize the truth in this very life. Om peace, peace, peace. May peace be unto us and may peace be unto all.
Om Hari Om.